Hello, my dear learners. Welcome to EPG Parshala. I am Devraj Goyal from Central Institute of Educational Technology, NCERT, New Delhi. Today we will focus on the topic Enhancement of Creative Writing Ability of Student Teachers through Participatory Approach. It is with the course Perspectives, Issues and Research in Teacher Education. Let us delineate the objectives. After going through this module, the learners will be able to express the components of creative composition of a poem with meaning, identify the occurrence of components of creative composition and their levels on a scale, compose and evaluate poems, and develop their capabilities on creative writing. Dear learners, all the creatures communicate through a language. Wish we could communicate through the language of each and every creator. Wish we could have a universal language. Natural language is the language of cries, laughter, and tones, that of eyes, nose, mouth, the whole face, the language of gestures and postures. The child's cry tells of its wants, its sob of grief, its scream of pain, its laugh of delight. The child raises eyebrows in surprise and nose in disgust, leans forward in expectation, draws back in fear, makes a fist in anger, and calls the dog simply by tone. However, feelings and desires are not the only things we wish to communicate. We have to communicate a lot. We have to communicate a lot. Early in life, we begin to acquire knowledge and learn to think, and then we feel the need of a better language or better expression. For instance, we have formed an idea of a day. Could we express this idea by a tone, a look, or gesture? Perhaps not. If we wish to say the fact that yesterday was cloudy, or that the days are shorter than in winter than in summer, we find it wholly impossible to do this by means of natural language. To communicate, then our thoughts or even the mental picture called ideas, we need a language more nearly perfect. This language is our mother tongue. We learn them also from our friends and teachers, playmates and companions, and by reading. For words, as we know, may be written as well as spoken. The word language we may, from its superiority, call language proper. Every creature has a language for communication. By using a language, we can win the hearts of others. With the same language, we can degrade ourselves in the society. Language helps a person in the development of personality. But it does not exist in vacuum. In fact, it gives rise to a society. The society, in turn, reshapes and remodels the language according to its needs and desires. Both language and society are deeply interrelated with each other. Without a language, the human society is unthinkable. Language is the flesh and blood of our culture. It helps in the preservation of culture and civilization of the people. It is also needed to secure national integrity and solidarity. The quality of education depends to a large extent on the quality of teachers involved in its development and delivery. A quality teacher will acknowledge the needs and interests of the people, permit the people to learn at his own pace, encourage learning through doing, and where necessary, provides remedial and enrichment instruction. Involving the learners as agents of change in their personal growth through education impacts the curricular process. In following a predetermined curriculum, the teacher tries to find the most effective ways to convey the information to the students, a one-way process. A key factor in the participatory approach is flexibility, in that the teacher must be willing to be open to student involvement, dialogue, and possible criticism, and ready to make adjustments in the class curriculum. The student must be permitted emotional expression in order that he may be taught to discipline his emotions. His shy fancies must be drawn out for the good of the soul. There is a necessity not only to teach, but also to learn properly both these languages to express oneself and to perform day-to-day functions, which can be done by providing exposure for creative writing. one cannot experiment with language and explore its infinite possibilities. Creative writing cannot be explained as a normative science because creative writing has its own natural, spontaneous outflow expression. Poetry is fusion of thought and feeling and often yearns to communicate beyond language. The poetry manifests where language fails. Poetry and its importance. Poetry enables teachers to connect with their students in new ways. Teacher can show students that poetry is something people do to capture thoughts, feelings, and experience, where even the remotest elements are interconnected, and there lies the beauty of interconnection and expression and finding meaning with it. When poetry is incorporated across the curriculum, students learn to make discoveries by looking at their environment in new ways. Poetry stands apart from storytelling and language lessons because of its ability to inspire personal expression. Montessori said that the teacher must entice the children. Through poetry, a teacher may find a way to entice children in wondrous ways not before realized, because it is poetry. These are the poems which are in a position to communicate the most hidden, the most latent, the most manifest, anything for that matter. A teacher can entice children with varied rhythms and create language of a poem. However, the teacher must also have an enthusiasm for poetry. Hence, it is essential for the teachers to know about it and for removing shyness, boredom, and make the lesson interesting. Poetry should be included for motivation because it is through finding meaning with something that we are in a position to compose and create. So motivation has to be there. If creative writing is usually an introduction to commercial writing and poetry is never a paying proposition, why include poetry? And poetry is in fact not for commercial purpose. It is for spontaneous expression. It is for natural expression. It is for emotions. It is emotive expressions. It is finding meaning with what we are saying. What is the object? Then what is the object? To get the creative juices flowing, or simply develop a more and adventurous and flexible prose style. Poetry is the workshop of language, the most acute and comprehensive way we have of expressing ourselves. And in poetry, the medium is words. In fact, the poetry is in highly condensed form, in highly resonating way, in highly rhythmic way, in highly economic way. And it is that vehicle of communication through which we can save our energies, but still with better expression. Prose may employ ready-made phrases, but poetry works at a deeper level with spontaneous expression. One essential distinction between poetry and prose lies in the more sustained and elaborate attention paid to its constituent parts. Words of poets have meanings, appropriate uses, associations, connotations, etymologies, histories of use and misuse. They conjure up images, feelings, shadowy depths, and glinting surfaces. Their properties are marvelous, endless, not to be guessed at from casual inspection. Each property, meaning, association, weight, color, duration, shape, and texture changes as words are combined in phrases, rhythms, lines, stanzas, and completed poems. Out of these properties, the poetry is built. Even if the end cannot be entirely foreseen, but grows out of the very process of composition, the very process of deployment, that is continual, two-way dialogue between poet and poem. Poems start in odd phrases, an image, a tune in the head, a deeply incoherent pain. How these develop in the poetry? There is nothing difficult in stringing words together, not the exacting research a good journalist may undertake, or the back-breaking labor of novel writing. It is in responding to what has been written, feeling it, understanding it, and extending its possibilities with imagination, honesty, and sensitivity. But that means very fine discriminations, verbal originality, wide sympathies, generosity of heart, and a compassion for the human condition are essential for poetry. But they are nothing without extended toil. Poetry trains the character needed to be an artist. The infinite capacity to be honest and take pains. Poetry also calls for self-criticism, which becomes essential as the talents of a writer develop. Literary criticism hones many skills, and those which the practicing poet needs are close reading, explication and evaluation, and the first two because poems commonly fail through lack of care. The originating emotion still clothes the lines, or in striving for originality, the work becomes muddled, pretentious, or incoherent. The incomprehensible can always be taken for the profound, of course, and no doubt gets published for that reason, but only the beginner will see publication as the sole purpose of writing. Then there is literary theory. Poetry is a dense and compact medium. It is also an art form serving no practical ends. What better medium exists to ask such questions as, what purpose does language serve? How does it mediate between us and the outside world? No doubt, the answers are hard to arrive at. Humanism believed in the perfectibility of man. New criticism had a simplistic psychology. Structuralism drew up fanciful analogies between literature and society. Semiotics misread its originators. Post-structuralisms continue to push theories contrary to common sense and the authorities quoted. But all speculation gets the writer thinking, and there is surely a need for some theoretical support in a career that is not overly rewarded or well regarded. Elements of poetry. The poetry has mainly four elements. One, emotion. Poetry is one of the most emotionalized elements of literary form. Emotion is the soul of poetry, which is directly related with the human hearts. Poem refines the human spirits and emotions. When Mahadevi Verma says, "Main neer bhari dukki badli." Intellect. Poetry is an intellectual exercise. Poets bring some social problems to the fore through poems. Shwano ko milta dood vastra, bhuke balak akulate hain. Imagination. Poetry has a lot of space for imagination. According to this line, poets imagine a lot. Jahan hai pahunche ravi, wahan pahunche kavi. Style. Poetry has similar sounding words. Due to this, it is easy to learn and recite. Sulgi anurag ki aag wahan, jal se bharpoor tadag jahan. Components of creative writing in poems. Organization. Sequential or spatial or both the forms in which a body of knowledge, idea, things or other elements is purposefully arranged. Kalry says that poetry is the best words in best order. Hum pakshi unmukt gagan ke, hamein bandho prachiron se. Then the next element is originality. Every poem ought to have the novelty, the newness. It has to be a creative, innovative expression. Uniqueness of the ideas which is statistically uncommon, like pyar ka bulb fuse ho gaya. Then another element of poetry is richness or elaboration. Any poem for that matter has to be rich, and it has to be above what the society already obtains, what the nature already obtains. It has to be added to that. It has to have an element of richness. The number of details supplied beyond those necessary to communicate basic ideas. Then we go on to assonance. Assonance is a type of rhyme where only the vowels rhyme or are similar sounding. Charu chandr ki chanchal kirne khel rahi thi jalthal mein. Then another element is repetition. Repetition of a sound, syllable, word, phrase, line, stanza, or metrical pattern is a basic unifying device in all poetry. Poot kapoot to kyon dhan sanchay, poot sapoot to kyon dhan sanchay. It is highly rhythmic. Then another element is rhyme. A rhyme is a repetition of similar sounds in two or more words and is most often used in poetry and songs. The word rhyme may also refer to a short poem, such as a rhyming couplet, or other brief rhyming poem, such as nursery rhymes. Titli Rani, Piti Ras, Batati Pani. Another element is simile. The most commonly used elements, it directly compares one object to another using words as though, as if, as and like. Just as Sita Vadan Chandra Samsundar. Then another element is metaphor. It is similar to simile but uses indirect comparison. It compares two things by saying one thing is another thing. It does not use the words like or as. Jalta hai yah jivan patang. Hyperbole. It is another very commonly used in poem, which simply when translated means exaggeration. Hanuman ki poonch mein lagne paayi aag, Lanka sari jal gayi, gaye nishachar bhag. Then tautology. Tautology means the repetition of the same word more than once in a line. Rahiman pani rakhiye, bin pani sab soon, pani gaye na ubre, moti manush chun. Alliteration. Alliterations imply the repetition of the same sound or letter, usually at the beginning of a word. A very common example for alliteration, which we would all recognize, would be tongue twisters. Charu chandra ki chanchal kirne khel rahi thi jalthal mein. Then we go on to personification. It simply means making inanimate things behave a very human-like way. Megh mein aasman se utar rahi, sandhya sundari parisi, dhire, dhire, dhire. Onomatopoeia. It uses the sound of whatever it is describing. Ghan ghamand garjat nabghora. Then, litotes. This is generally used in humorous context. It creates an impact by denying the opposite of what is true. Sab koi kahat, Ram suno sadhu, Ram sadhu, tum sadhu sayane. Oxymoron. It is a contradictory phrase. Achal ho utte chanchal, chapal ban jate avichal. Then we go on to transferred epithet. It is an epithet which has been transferred from the word to which it strictly belongs to. Kalpne, aao sajni us pyar ki, sajal sudhi mein, magan ho jaye punah. Antithesis. It is the use of words with opposite meaning in the same line. Hai daanton ki jhalak mujhko dikhti daadimon mein. Anaphora. It is the repetition of words or phrases at the beginning of successive clauses. Poot kapoot to kyon dhan sanchay, poot sapoot to kyon dhan sanchay. Phrase. A phrase is usually a group of words with some special idiomatic meaning or other significance. Lena anal kreet bhal par o aashik hone wale. Then we go on to paradox. It is a seemingly contradictory statement at first reading, but yet on deepest perusal makes sense. Saraswati ke bhandar ki badi apurav baat, jo kharche tyon to badhe, bin kharche ghati jaat. Now we focus on creative writing. Creative writing is considered to be one of the most perplexing forms of articulating thoughts and ideas on paper. It turns out to be a hard nut to crack because it requires the ability to think freely, giving thoughts a medium of leeway and express ideas and feelings naturally and spontaneously. Creative writing permits the author to deviate from the specific writing style and not to be consistent with all the standards of this style. That is, creative writing gives the author leeway in terms of presentation and development of a piece of writing. Creative approach treats all writing as a creative act, that requires time, positive feedback, and inspiration to be done well. People who engage in creative writing do not merely think freely, they view the world from free-thinking perspective. The key to success in creative writing lies in the author's ability to be frank with his readers and honest with himself. Do not be afraid to step aside from the established standards of the particular writing style and open the door of our brain to the new ideas that cross the threshold of our imagination and knock around our minds. Remember that process and explorations are the keystones in creative writing, rather than the finished products. Let ourselves release our inner genius and vent on paper the most bizarre ideas that amassed in our minds. Forms of creative writing. These can be various forms of creative writing, such as short story, novel, poetry, screenwriting, playwriting, dramatic writing, autobiography, memoir, and creative nonfiction, personal and journalist essays. There are no limits in creative writing as far as genre is concerned. Students can try short stories, dialogues in short dramatic scenes, and poems. The main constraint is time, and therefore most texts will have to be relatively short. For this reason, it may be useful to focus on poetry as perhaps the most condensed of all the possible genres. It can be said that poetry is that which arrives at the intellect by way of the heart. The easiest way for the students to try their hand at composing their own pieces of poetry is according to Odell, 1998, Carter and Long, 1987, to write something with a very clear structure, such as acoustics, haiku, and limerick poems. Bearing in mind the fact that the students are between 15 to 19 years of age, when they dream a lot and fall in love for the first time, they can be given the opportunity to share their feelings associated with friendship, love, music, and life. The purpose of creative writing. Creative writing symbolizes release from repressive discipline and is free in nature. In a world of rules and order, ways of escape are often necessary, especially for children. Make-believe fantasy is often puzzling to the child, and while he may adhere to the traditional rules of society, in his imagination, he frequently enjoys a release. Writing can provide such an escape, whereby he can give vent to his wildest thoughts and be a source of fun and adventure. The focus of creative writing is to give the child scope to express himself in self-satisfying way and ensure a sense of competency in language, which will enable him to express and appreciate not only his own writing, but also that of others, thus opening the way for his fuller enjoyment of the richness of literature. The child may also be able to understand himself better through his writing. One of the chief distinguishing characteristics of creative writing texts is a playful engagement with language, stretching and testing its rules to the limit in a guilt-free atmosphere where risk is encouraged. Such writing combines cognitive with affective modes of thinking. Not only does creative writing offer the learner the variety they need, but it rewards them for the efforts as well. Students get used to handling language better by producing their own pieces of writing. In fact, this is the only way they find the new meaning is added to the vocabulary and grammar structure they are familiar with. The teacher of language surely have a responsibility to keep primary resource alive and well. Creative writing seems to have an effect on the writer's level of energy in general. This tends to make teachers take interest in creative writing composed by students, and this inevitably impacts on their relationship with students. Any experienced teacher knows that students get easily bored unless the activities they are involved in are varied and meaningful. The activities included in creative writing classes can make the lesson less boring and more pleasant and useful. It is only later that teenage students would realize how much they have learned by playing with words, rhyme, and a fixed number of lines and syllables. Of course, the younger the students, the easier the exercises. So they can start with guessing exercises consisting of filling in missing words or missing lines. Recording jumbled lines is another way leading to the understanding of poetry and finally to writing it. Poets' patterns, pictures, suggestions, given topics take students from guided poetry to personal productions. Creative writing can be taught by using different learner-centered approaches, which includes group activities. Participatory approach can also be very helpful to teacher and learner to creative writing, in which the teacher himself becomes facilitator and co-learner. Now we go on to participatory approach. Participatory approach, also known as Freirean approach, is a teaching strategy that incorporates themes or content area that are of interest to the learners. Freire contends that unjust social circumstances originate from illiteracy, and the reason for seeking education is to empower learners to take proactive stance in liberating themselves from their burden, Spencer 1992. The participatory approach is under the umbrella of contents-based instruction, is that it uses topics for specific purposes. The themes derives from real issues that affect students' daily lives, where language learning is used as a vehicle to solve social problems. There are various activities that can be incorporated in this teaching strategy, which aims to develop all language domains in the learning process. According to Arbeck, as cited in Ross 1995, learners are also encouraged to take ownership of their learning as well as collaborate with the teacher, including participating in small and whole group activities for learning to be meaningful. However, in the participatory approach, meaning precedes form. A classroom using a participatory approach uses two-way dialogue, problem posing, and problem solving strategies while using language learning as a vehicle. Problem posing and problem solving activities support for critical thinking and creative ways to address learners' pressing social issues. Participatory approach is more process-based than product-based. In its outcome with participatory approach, students are encouraged to work with fellow students, either in pairs, small groups, or in whole group for collective participation. Activities such as role plays, writing a letter to school board or city management staff, compose a poem, and other functional exponents using the target language and language domains make an important facet in the students' learning, because these are the tools that will help students liberate from their problems. A participatory approach not only develops words and themes meaningful to learner, but also extends those themes and activities into action that will better the learner's lives. Members of the literacy team spend time in the communities developing lists of words and vocabulary that were key to the life there. From these lists, they chose generative words that became the basis for helping learners develop basic decoding and encoding skills. Since then, his ideas have been adopted by government-sponsored literacy program and by non-governmental organizations throughout the world. Also called participatory or liberatory education, Freirean approaches revolve around the discussion of issues drawn from learners' real-life experiences. The term participatory is often used interchangeably with learner-centered. Indeed, the participatory approach is also a learner-centered approach, in that the content and learning objectives are determined through ongoing dialogue between teacher and learners. The participatory approach, however, goes beyond a learner-centered approach because it advocates literacy as a vehicle for personal transformation and social change. Learners discuss issues in class that are significant to them and determine ways of dealing with these issues in real life. Learners are seen as agents for change, for bettering their lives and the lives of those close to them. This may involve a parent using literacy to help a child with her schooling or to advocate for the child within the school. Thus, the participatory approach extends the themes discussed in class to action outside the classroom. The central tenet is that education and knowledge have value only insofar as they help people liberate themselves from the social conditions and oppress them. The following concepts are central: generative words and themes. These are the basis for conversation, reading, and writing activities. Learners begin with encoding and decoding exercises and move to more complex activities. Collaboration and dialogue among equals. A traditional lecture format where the teacher talks and the learners listen passively is replaced by a culture circle where teachers and learners face one another and discuss issues of concern in their lives. Problem posing, using objects, pictures, and written text, teachers and learners describe what they see, examine the relationships among the objects and people represented, and talk about how they feel about what they see. Ultimately, they articulate the problem illustrated and propose solutions. Among adult educators in the United States, Frere's ideas have been adapted to fit diverse learners and educational context. The primary revision is the notion of emergent curriculum, or back 1992, where learners identify their own problems and issues and seek their own solutions. Teachers, freed from doing extensive research to identify problems for learners, become facilitators of class discussions and activities and learn along with the class. Fingret, 1989, defines participatory literacy education as a philosophy and a set of practices based on the belief that learners, their characteristics, aspirations, backgrounds, and needs should be at the center of literacy instruction. Learners help to define, create, and maintain the program. For example, a teacher may learn from a Hispanic family that their children have been raised to value cooperative rather than individual work. Thus, rather than viewing the child's hesitancy to engage in competitive behavior in the class in a negative light, the teacher appreciates this cultural difference and provides more opportunities for the child to engage in group work within the class. Now, let us conclude this topic on creative writing. Here, every individual is creative in some respect or the other. Due to the phenomenal complexity of our genetic makeup and the uniqueness of each life experience, we are as distinct as snowflakes. This dissimilarity is the basis for our creativity. We each have unique perspective to express, a completely different set of talents and experiences to translate through our individual skill. It is this process of finding and listening to that individual's perspective which results in the expression of our creativity. Creativity, thus, is the translation of ourself into tangible expression. Accordingly, works of art, music, solutions to problems in our careers, style in dress, hobbies, dance or other expressive activities are all acts of creativity. All have their own thoughts and ideas according to their environment. In early childhood, every individual expresses thoughts in small sentences. At times, it is in the form of rhyme, because children find it easy to express their thoughts in the rhymes and songs. But after childhood, or in the middle of adolescence stage, all the attitudes of composing words in the shape of poems are not sustained among the children. Thank you.